Good afternoon to all of you, and thank you, Mr. Deesipan, for the introduction. The theme that we have today is a very, very interesting and important theme: the VUCA world. When you look at the phrase which has become very popular for the last couple of years in terms of volatile, uncertain, complex, and ambiguous, it is seen as something which is very negative or dangerous. Something. Lots of research studies have said there will be no jobs, there will be this thing, that thing, humans will be redundant, robots will rule over us, all kinds of things have been said. And what I want to do in the next 15-20 minutes, and that's a big challenge for a professor who's used to speaking for an hour without making a point, that we are actually headed for a visible, unbounded, the huge amount of opportunities that are coming, problems to be solved, challenging, and an awesome world. And this is what I want to convince you about. So don't take the story of pessimism and so on, but look at all the bright things that are going to happen. This expression, VUCA world, actually got into sort of currency in January 2016 when Klaus Schwab in the World Economic Forum talked to us about the fourth industrial revolution. And I'll spend some time on this evolution and build it to this thing. In the pre-industrial age, which was still about 1700 or so, the only source of energy that we had was raw muscular power. Human beings as the first source of power, and that is why men were considered more valuable because they were a little stronger in terms of energy. And people tell you, and Shashi Tharoor has said this several times, that 300 years ago, India was the largest economy with 25% GDP, etc., etc., because we had most energy. We had humans, we had domesticated animals, we had slaves, we had minions, we had petty servants. All this gave us so much energy that we could make the Taj Mahal, 20,000 people over 12 years. We made the Konark Temple. In Egypt, they made the pyramids. In Rome, they made the Colosseum. All these kinds of things could happen because of this manual energy that we had. So human and animal energy, augmented by technology of those days. Technology of those days was the lever, the inclined plane, and the pulley. Don't underestimate the lever. The lever was such a powerful thing that when Archimedes understood the principle of the lever, he said, "Give me a place to stand on, and I can move the earth." And in a sense, I'm going to build that same spirit. Let me get a grip on AI and I will change the world and I will be leader. So what Klaus Schwab said, that this is what happened in the pre-industrial, lots of glorious things happened. But when we discovered the power of steam, the first industrial revolution happened. And steam was used both for locomotion as well as boilers in factories. This led to huge manufacturing. This led to actually the glory of England, where, for example, then the colonies would make all the cotton. The cotton will go to England and Manchester would manufacture textiles, and which then later on Gandhiji would try to oppose. And this kind of thing happened. And lots of people rose in that time. For those of you who have a background in literature, Charles Dickens' Tale of Two Cities, opening lines reflects the French Revolution and the Industrial Revolution. And he says there, hundreds of years ago, it was the best of times, it was the worst of times. It was the age of wisdom, it was the age of foolishness. It was the epoch of belief, it was the epoch of incredulity. It was the spring of hope, it was the winter of despair. We're all going towards heaven, we're all going to, and so on and so forth. The point is, exactly the same phrases come to mind to us today in this VUCA world. It will be the best of times for people who will be able to harness this technology and come to terms with it. It will be the worst of times for those who are left behind. Of course, people like to say that this is going to create inequities, but inequities happen because of this. So that's interesting. Now, this went on merrily for about 100 years, till this guy called Edison discovered the electric lamp. But Edison was not a typical inventor who was very happy. "Look here, I've made this and nobody else understands what I've done, but this world is very cruel, I am very great," and so on. No. He said, "I have to live in the world. If this lamp is to be used, electricity has to come here. So electricity distribution has to happen. Before I distribute, I must generate it somewhere." And therefore he formed these companies, General Electric and others, and had this whole ecosystem which brought electricity to the people. There's a very interesting side effect. And I'm saying this because whenever something new happens, we often worry that, you know, the old will just go away and it will all be replaced. It doesn't happen. The old also changes. So when this electric bulb got created around 18 something, there were already oil companies. Oil companies were there, but they were not working very hard. They created kerosene. They would market kerosene. Kerosene was sold as lamp oil in the UK, as kerosene oil elsewhere. And we used to have all our lights and street lights and even Janta cooker. All was happening with kerosene. They were quite comfortable. But when they saw their market will go on lighting to the electric bulb, they invested a little more effort on petrol and diesel and created the petrol engine and the diesel engine. And this is where the second industrial age was a glorious age, because you had a petrol engine, diesel engine, you had electric motors, even electric toothbrushes and blenders and grinders and so on and so forth. And that was in some sense great times to be had. This continued till about 1970, because one of the problems that happened in this age, you could do all this, you could have motors, you could have this, but there was very little automation. The only automation that happened was by way of electromagnetic circuits, like in an electric bell or in the self of your car or automatically opening doors. They were all electromagnetic devices. So it will be a relay. The current will flow, it will break the circuit, current will then not flow, and so on and so forth. But around 1970s, electronics took good shape. So you had the diode, the triode, the valve, the chips, and so on and so forth, and computers, PCs in 1980s and so on. And this is what he calls the third industrial age. India was a special beneficiary in the third industrial age because it created the IITs just in time. The IITs were created in the 1960s. Their first graduates came out in 1965, and therefore they were ready in terms of time for the third industrial age. IIT Kanpur, where I was around that time, was probably the only educational institution with a computer for themselves. And the students therefore learned to program, they used Fortran, punch cards, whatever. And therefore they were ready to move on to the Silicon Valley, etc., which happened, and all the glory that came. This also gave a sense of settlement to people. You had a formula where you sent your children to the best schools. In Delhi it was what, DPS, RK Puram, ability section or whatever. Then you got into IIT, then you got into something, and so on. When I was in IIT Kanpur, we had a director called Professor Sampath. He had a very nice way of describing this. He said, on the day a student joins IIT Kanpur, his soul migrates to the US. 4 years later, his body follows. Now, that was true. The IIT Delhi soul migrated to UK, the IIT Kanpur soul migrated to US, IIT Chennai soul migrated to Germany, IIT Powai couldn't migrate because Russia wouldn't take any souls. So they went to the other countries. So even IIT Bombay went to US, to UK, and so on. And of course, 4 years later, the bodies followed. This is, in a sense, the bane, because we were put into a sense of complacency that we have a very deterministic world. You do the right thing from early school to college, do this, and you will have a great career. That is what is now shattered, and that is what, because now there is Trump. So the whole thing is very different, and this is what the complex, uncertain world is. But my training comes from the field of physics and computing and law and so on and so forth. So I am not at all unhappy about it. In fact, some of you must have studied physics in your school. Raise your hands. Okay, great. So you know, one of the interesting things, and I want to point this seriously because not many people appreciate that. They think this is now terrible times coming. Physics had its most glorious time when it accepted something called Heisenberg's uncertainty principle. What is this? Uncertainty age. So age of uncertainty was the greatest glory of physics and engineering and electronics and technology. So we should not be afraid of uncertainty, of complex, of ambiguous, and so on. And this is very interesting, because on the face of it, Heisenberg's uncertainty principle looks a space back. In Newtonian physics, life was very simple. You knew the initial conditions, knew what were the forces, you could determine everything. That was like sending your soul to US and then the body following. Now, all quantum mechanics, all solid-state physics, all laser, everything has come out of quantum phenomena, including superconductivity, superfluidity, and By our 13th EduConvex, you will be having a session on quantum computing. I can guarantee you that. So that's where the world is. So it's, we should be very excited that now there is something new, the limitations in which we were of the so-called deterministic and assuring world is now conquered. And therefore, as I said, we have a visible world, we have an abundant world, we have an whatever. Okay, I must use the slides also. See, I think I usually don't like to use PowerPoint slides. I have said very often, power corrupts the politician and PowerPoint corrupts the academic. So I don't really like it. But you see, it has become some kind of a dress code. So if you come to a presentation with all eminent people like you and I don't use PowerPoint, then people will think that, oh, he doesn't know technology, etc. So this is why it is being used. So fourth industrial age. It's very important to understand. So we have, for most of our time, seen a division. So you said physics and chemistry. Then in physics, you had solid-state physics, nuclear physics, particle physics, electronics, and so on. Chemistry, you had organic chemistry, inorganic chemistry, etc., etc., biochemistry. And we had an age of specialization. And it was so specialized that eventually we knew more and more about less and less, until we knew everything about nothing. So the point was that now we are coming to a stage of integration. So it's no use being a hyper specialist, can you? And the world doesn't come to us. Have you seen the world come to us divided? This is physics, this is chemistry, this is math, this is arithmetic, this is sociology, this is anthropology, this is psychology. Everything is, comes to us as one, our experience of the world. We did this compartmentalization because at one time it was convenient to do that because you could not process all that information because computers were not there. Now, had computers been there, we would have probably come into a different way. And I think this is one of the things about early education. And this is the great thing that we talk about Finland education, that you don't try to do all that. You say, here is an issue, now you want to understand. So when you look at the quantitative part, you get mathematics. When you look at some other part, you get something, and so on. So what is there is that this is now the fusion of three worlds, the physical world, the world of atoms and energy. The information world, the world of bits and qubits. Qubits are about quantum computing, which will happen in the 13th EduConvex. And of course the biological world, the world of neurons and genes. See, we don't realize that in the last 60 years, our knowledge of genes has grown from just Crick and Watson getting the Nobel Prize to today people telling you, you should not drink coffee because your genetic disposition is not right. That you will get medicine which is based on your gene map. And there is a company called 23andMe to which you send your spit and it will give you a whole gene map, etc. Not only that, if you don't like what's in your genes, you can use CRISPR to edit that, delete a gene, like in software, add a gene, delete a gene, activate a gene, suppress a gene, and you can create whatever you want. And this is the world, and that's why I said use the world of humans, where we are going to live in. And it's a very exciting world, although it may be an unfamiliar. Why are we talking of megatrends? We're talking megatrends because we don't know the details. We know broadly this is going to happen. What exactly is going to happen, we don't quite know, and that is what the excitement is all about. And the megatrends have been looked at various places, think tanks, etc. do that. We have identified a few, which we have said in one of our earlier conferences also. We're talking virtual reality, augmented reality, which Arul will show you. We talk about Internet of Things. We talk about digital manufacturing or 3D printing, on which Avikshit has a book which he has just created, which will be launched around this time. We're talking about robots and drones. We're talking about blockchain, mobile computing, computational thinking, on which there's a book by Anupam Kaushik. So what we're trying to say is that we are not just talking about these as buzzwords. We want to take it further. So today, if you want a course on computational thinking for your children, Anupam Kaushik is ready with it, and so on and so forth. And then machine intelligence, big data, and we'll talk to you a little bit about machine intelligence, which is most important. What do you... Anyway, so this is one part of technology. But the other thing, and I want to draw serious attention to that, is that our biggest problem is we don't understand mathematics. The world is now moving towards more complicated mathematics. What we call mathematics, which we teach in school, is Euclidean geometry, which is what? 600 years old. maybe 1200 years old, I don't know. And it was created for solving the problem which was called the curse of the Nile, that Nile would come, water would flood, land would disappear, you get back, so you want to know, is this area equal to this area? If it is to be divided family, how do I get this divided into bisection, trisection, and so on? And you were taught how to find the third side of a triangle given two sides and the internal angle. How many did you have to do that in life? Finding the third side of a triangle. Right? So that mathematics is now you may call mathematics of history. Tomorrow's mathematics is going to be linear algebra, it is going to be calculus, it is going to be optimization techniques, it will be multi-dimensional thinking. You see, you were taught geometry, point has no dimension, line has one dimension, this. We are now talking of multi-dimensional because we are taking more complex challenges. So everything that you pick up, when you look at its attributes, it will become multidimensional attributes. So everything that you want to deal with it will have to look at multiple dimensions simultaneously. And you cannot condense it to one at a time. That's why it's called a complex problem. You know, today I will look only about the one dimension and I will forget everything else. So it's like flying a plane. I will look only at height today, not look at the amount of fuel. Next time I will look at the fuel, I won't worry about the height. This doesn't happen. And this is what is interesting and important about the future. So exponential function is a reality now, which was not so in the past. So today, you hear when you hear rapid growth, etc., you hear exponential growth. And I will quickly talk to you about three other forms. There's a power law, which is very important. Power law is something like something to the power x. In literature, in Ernest Hemingway's play, there is somewhere something that he asked, so how did you become bankrupt? He said, first slowly, then very rapidly. Because the equation was 2 to the power minus x. So initially, it did not look very much, but after a while, it was better. This is what is happening to us. We do not realize we are using our ground first slowly, and then very rapidly. So you hear all the data about engineers being unemployable, this thing. It was not so 10 years ago. But we will. So this is the singularity is something word which will come very often nowadays is something where things change. So typically they say with exponential function and typically machine intelligence rising so fast that one day it will surpass human intelligence. That day is not very far. The only debate is when will the singularity happen? So whether it will happen 2040 or 2050 or whatever, and you will have, we shouldn't get very upset. There are machines which travel faster than us. Right, the cars travel faster, just planes fly which we can't do, ships sail which we can't do, submarines go inside which we can't do. So if some machines can do something faster than us, why should we be upset? But lots of people are, and if you remind me, I'll come back to that part also. The inverse problem is a very important aspect. See, we are so far used to the direct problem. Everybody say, we will do this, we will have a GDP of 8%, 7%, 6%, 3%, then they'll fight, etc. Inverse problems are where you know something and you want to know why it happened. So you know that sine theta is something. So you know sine 30 is half. I said, you know, here is an angle whose sine is half. What is the angle? That's the inverse problem. So I have a gravitational thing. I see what its field is. I'm saying, I've seen this is the measurement of G. What is inside? And this is used by people who are looking at petrol exploration and mineral exploration and so on. So you've got something which you can observe and say, what is inside? The inverse problem is going to be very important, and I will tell you why. Because now I say, there are no jobs, there's no industry, how do I survive? So I say, if I want an income of this, what do I need to do? And this is a very, very interesting part. So instead of saying, if I do this, I will get this income. Turn it around and say, I want this money. What do I need to do to get it? And it's not such a difficult thing. I also want to quickly venture into the new economics that I am seeing happening. We've kind of got conditioned over the last whatever decades to think that this method of industry and government services employing people is the only method, and that's why we worry, where will the jobs be? But this need not be true. The Companies Act is a couple of hundred years old. Before that, there were no companies. There were other things, right? The Industrial Revolution is just a few hundred years old. So why do we believe that this few hundred years old of way of existence is the existence that will always happen? And I just want to propose quickly what I think is the new model. See, you are typically a consumer. And they are the producers, right? The Tatas and the Birlas and the Mukesh Ambanis, they are the producers, we are the consumers. The future is about us being prosumers. We will be producers as well as consumers. And typically as we move into the knowledge age, all people who will flourish will be knowledge prosumers. Now you might think this is some fiction of imagination, and has Dr. Pant already started drinking so early in the evening? The answer is no. The answer is no. Now you have heard in the energy context, you heard of solar energy, you heard that there are models where you can create solar energy and the extra that you generate you can feed to the grid. Right? That is a prosumer. Therefore, there will be a knowledge prosumer thing. Your raw material is knowledge. Your processing ability is human as this thing who is processing knowledge, augmented with all the IT that is available, and now you will create something which others will have. So you'll have a whole society of knowledge presumers. Today we have a society of, we mentioned about this, you become engineer, lawyer, doctor, etc. These are all professionals, they will all become knowledge presumers. So as a lawyer, I will learn about things, take care of my cases, also have surplus which I can share with others. So anyway, I mean, this is the kind of things that is going to happen. AI is the new electricity. This is a quote by Andrew Ng. Very important, just to give you an idea of the implications that it has. This is an example of AI, machine learning, deep learning. These are nested things. AI is an old field. This is talked about since 1956. One part of it was machine learning, and today what people say is deep learning is synonymous with AI. The conceptual difference, and this is something people need to understand. In earlier times, what you would call the earlier programming model, you had data, you had a problem, so you wrote a program for this, and you pushed it into a computer, the computer ran that and gave you the results. If you wanted to do word processing, you put a word processing program. If you wanted to do Excel spreadsheets, you put the Excel program. If you want to make a PowerPoint slide, you put a PowerPoint program, it will do that. Tomorrow, in fact, even today's technology of machine learning and artificial intelligence, you don't have to make a program. You say, this is what I want to get done. These are samples of what I want to get, and you figure out how to do it. And this is the reason why the change is going to be enormous. Because now you don't have to program computers, you will train computers. So we're used to training dogs, we're used to taming lions, now we're used to training young kids, now you will train computers. And if the computer can do better than the young kid, why will you waste your time training the young kid? So this is something. Chatbots is another very important aspect. I just want to try to come, I'm not sure about the time, so I'm trying to. So this is a very interesting thing that I think. So all of you probably know that Jawaharlal Nehru was our first Prime Minister, right from the beginning, and he died on 27th May 1964, and he was immediately succeeded by Lal Bahadur Shastri. Lal Bahadur Shastri died under mysterious circumstances. Nowadays we see many deaths under mysterious circumstances. So he died under mysterious circumstances in a hotel in Tashkent. In fact, in one of my consulting to Tashkent, they were putting me in that hotel. I said, no, I'm not going to be here. I go somewhere else and sit up. But when Shastriji died, the issue was who will become Prime Minister. Congress Party was in power, it had majority, and S.K. Patil was one of the big bosses of the Congress Party. And he proposed to this gentleman, K. Kamraj, that why don't you become the Prime Minister? And he is said to have retorted, no Hindi, no English, how? And I am building on that to say that if you're looking at a future, sorry, what happened? No English, no AI, how? So if you want to have a future, you need to know English, you need to know AI, and only then the demographic dividend or the prosperity or flourishing the fourth industrial age that we see is going to happen. This can be done at the national level with an enlightened national leadership. I haven't said it doesn't exist. The possibility is there. At the state level, there are 29 states and 6 UTs. Any one of them could have the wisdom, but the possibility of Yogi Adityanath having that is extremely unlikely. At an educational institution or group of institutions, this is more likely. Leaders of educational institutions can decide that we want all our children to know AI, we want all of them to know computational thinking, and we will make sure that these people, by the time they leave school, are ready to face that world. It can happen at the family level. You may decide that, well, I will ensure that this happens, and you can move on to that. So this is then the agenda, and of course we can go on and on, and I'm very happy to interact with you on the world. But importance of English language in a VUCA world. So I said, no English, no AI, how? And so we drafted somebody who is going to talk to you about the importance of English language in a VUCA world. So the new VUCA, as I said, will become visible, unbounded, challenging, and awesome. And I hope you all have a great time and a great future for your children and grandchildren. And this is my contact for further. You will benefit if you become my follower on Twitter. I have about 1,000 tweets on matters educational. My tweet typically begins with a news item which I forward, and then I make some sarcastic comment related to that kind. I am on WhatsApp, I am on this thing, etc. So enjoy the day, and Roger, may I welcome you to take one part of the story.
Thank you very much.